Hello everyone, welcome once again. This is Papa's Happiness Story and my name is Judah. I'm so pleased to have you here today. If this is your first time, thank you so much for being here. If this is not your first time, I don't know how many times I want to say that I love you so much. I love you so much. Thank you for being here. And I hope that this message blesses you, inspires you, makes you desire to be closer to the Lord every single day. So before we begin today's episode, I just want to pray with us, if that's okay. So Father Lord, I thank you for another opportunity to come before your presence, to hear from you, to be taught by you, to learn from your heart. Thank you for everything that you teach us every time we come before you. It is a privilege to be taught by you. It is a privilege to learn from you. Lord, we ask that our hearts be open to receive every word that you teach us today. Let it come directly from your spirit to our spirit and to give us life. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Once again, thank you for being here. If someone is being here for the first time, Papa's Heart Ministry is a platform that we share the purposes of God, the plans of God for our lives, and at different times, the Lord gives us messages per season, what He wants us to learn, what He wants us to improve on. So today, I'm going to share a message that God gave me. It's from a Bible verse that the Lord gave me just as I was about to go to bed. The Lord gave me that scripture and I read it and I meditated on that scripture. But as I was asking the Lord, that what would you have me present to God's people on the platform, the Lord said, go ahead and talk about the scripture I gave you. I already shared it with some of the people who follow us, who follow Papa's Heart on WhatsApp group during the midnight prayer. We already have Sunday midnight prayer from 12 to 1 every Sunday, Sunday night. But the Lord is putting in my heart to share this with you. So the scripture that the Lord gave to me is actually in Jude only has one chapter, so he gave me the scripture in Jude verse 2, and so I'm going to read it. In Jude, this is the NIV translation, it says, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. It says, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Now for me, whenever God gives me a scripture, it tells me a lot about what His heart towards me is at a particular time. It tells me what He's thinking of concerning me, what His thoughts towards me is at that time. So that's the reason why whenever I get a scripture from the Lord, most times people think the scripture is all about maybe a particular circumstance you're going through or something that is happening. It's not always about that. Sometimes the Lord wants you to know what His thoughts towards you are at that particular time. So as I've been on a period of praying and fasting, and the Lord then gave me this word. I was thinking, Lord, I just want to study my Bible before going to bed. And then the Lord gave me this scripture. You know, I was thinking, what? Something that I can meditate on before I go to sleep. And then He gave me this scripture. And so this is NIV. NIV says, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. And I want to look at it in another translation. The English Standard Version, ESV, it says, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. It says, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. So, looking at this, the Lord is saying, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you, right? Now, this brings me to the thought that, why is God saying these words to me? Why is He saying to me, mercy, peace, and love be mine in abundance, be multiplied to me? What is the purpose of that word? Now God is asking to share this with you. Why is he giving you that word to say mercy, peace, and love? Now, the truth is, for everyone who is watching this, you are at different stages of your life. What you are experiencing may not be what I am experiencing. What other person is going through may not be what another person in another nation, in another state, in another city is experiencing at the point in time. So this message, this word is going to speak to each of us in different lights. But in all of it, I want you to know that the major thing, the focal point about this message is that God wants you to know what His thoughts towards you is at this time. Whatever situation you are experiencing at this time, God wants you to know that in His heart, what He wants you to know that His perspective, His view, His mindset, His thoughts towards you at this time is that mercy be multiplied to you, peace be multiplied to you, and that His unconditional love be made available to you in abundance. So what is mercy? Most people talk about is the unmerited favor. But let me explain what mercy has come to mean to me. For me, mercy has to do with the fact that there are so many reasons why we should be judged. Bible talks about the accuser of the brethren. There are so many things that we have done wrong. Perhaps it has to do with things that deal with your foundation. Things that parents, ancestors, many people did. Some situations that you know that as a result of this situation, I should be punished. I should be penalized. I should lose that marriage. I should lose that job. I shouldn't be given another chance in ministry. I shouldn't be given another chance even in the circumstances or even in relationships or life. But in all of this, God is saying that for Him, it doesn't matter how bad that situation is, He's saying that His thought towards you is mercy. And you may have judged yourself, you may have condemned yourself, everybody may have rightly pointed fingers at you, telling you how you are not suitable, how you are unfit. And you too may have believed it, saying that because I made this error, I am not qualified anymore, I am not fit anymore. But the Lord is saying that His thought towards you is mercy. And it's so beautiful because Jesus is the reason why we have mercy with God. Jesus is the reason why we are receiving mercy from the Father. Because He made that sacrifice for you, He made the sacrifice for me. And today God is saying to you in this book of Jude only has one verse. He said in this book of Jude, verse 2, God says mercy. You know, He could have said love first, He could have said peace first, but He first says mercy. And the reason why God is very precise when He's speaking to us, because the reason why He says mercy first is that you need to first know that I am not judging you, I have not condemned you, I have not considered you unworthy. It's like the woman that was caught in the act of adultery. Jesus, everybody else came with their accusations, you know, but Jesus did not look at her with accusations. Jesus only looked at her with the eyes of His mercy, because only He has the legal right to judge anyone. Bible says that judge not that you may not be judged. He said the only one who has the right to judge is the Father. You know, and now Jesus is saying to you that even though He, as your righteous judge, has the right to judge you on every situation that you are going through in your life, He's saying, I choose to give you mercy. I choose to administer mercy to you in that situation, in that family, whatever. Let's say you are going through challenges with your finances, you are going through challenges with your child. God is saying, over that matter, I'm speaking mercy over that matter. Perhaps you have prayed concerning that loved one. You are saying, God, this situation seems like it's not changing. God is saying, I am speaking mercy to you over that situation, over that one that is in the hospital, over that one that seems like they have lost their mind, over that one that seems to have run away from home, that is addicted, that seems like this situation will never come to an end. Jesus is saying, I choose to give you mercy. He said that, and He said, I'm not just giving you mercy. He said that it may be to you in abundance, to the beyond the measure that you desire. Beyond the measure that you need, Jesus is saying, I give you mercy. And I'm not just giving you mercy, I am multiplying my mercy to you. I am multiplying, making it in abundance to you. So at no point will you say, I don't have enough. He's saying it is like I've released it to you in abundance. And yes, circumstances around you will make you believe that I don't think this will ever happen. This thing is still like the Bible says that to him that believes, there shall be a performance to that which you have believed. So you first need to believe what Jesus is saying to you today. He's saying, I give you mercy. He's saying, I give you my mercy. You may have messed up. Maybe you went into satanic worship. You did all sorts of things. Jesus is saying, I give you mercy. That is what he says to us, come boldly to the throne of grace, that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help you in your time of need. Right now, Jesus is saying to you, I give you mercy. He needs you to be conscious of his mercy for you, because he needs, you know, many times, it's like a child that has done something wrong, that knows that I have totally messed up. Many reasons why they are not able to come back to the parents is because they feel that this parent, I can guarantee that my mother will never forgive me. I can guarantee that my father will never accept me back. I remember a particular situation that happened a long time ago. A young man had traveled away. I don't know where he went, maybe for school or something, but he did something wrong. And at this time, the parents, the dad had not spoken to him. Nobody wrote a letter, nothing. And he needed to go back home. And usually, they use a train to go through to get to the house. And the train usually passes the front of they have like a farmhouse. The train usually passed by the farmhouse, you know. So while he wrote a letter to the father and said, Dad, I am coming home. He said, so I'm going to be on this train that passes at so time. He said, if you have forgiven me and you have accepted me, he said, he asked for either for a particular, he said, just put a flower, a particular color of flower, I can't remember what it was. He said, put it out, so that put it on a particular place, so that as the train is taking him past the house and he sees it, he will know that the father has forgiven him and that he can stop by and come home. Guess what the father did? I know that is how Jesus is to us. When this young man was in that train, he kept looking out, we are approaching his house. The train was approaching his house and he was going. And when they got to where their own land was, guess what? The entire front of the house was filled with that color of flowers. Filled with that color of flowers. There's so many of them. It's like that means his father was saying to him, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you. I want you to come out. The guy jumped, when the train stopped, he came out and he just kept running and running. You know, that is what God wants you to know. That's why, so that is what he meant by abundance. That's what he meant by multiplying, in a multiplied version. When he said, my mercy is available for you, it is multiplied unto you. The boy expected one flower, but the father did so many that the entire front yard was filled with that color of flower. You know, so God is saying that just like that one, he's saying to you today, my mercy over that situation that your family is going through, over that thing that you are, that academic situation, that financial, maybe you are in debt, and maybe you are about to lose your home, God is saying, I'm giving you multiplied mercy. I'm giving you multiplied mercy. By the time you are going for that interview again, maybe every circumstances have shown that you are not even supposed to get that opportunity. But Jesus is saying to you today, I am giving you multiplied mercy. And perhaps you even go there and they have said no, they have rejected you. God is saying to you, yes, they rejected you, but he as your father has not rejected you. So he's saying to you, you need to trust him. They have said no to you over there, but he's saying yes to you. That means he has something greater. He has something bigger for you. And he's saying to you, perhaps you're about to make a decision concerning, should I go here? Should I go not go? Should I travel? Should I take that international opportunity or not? God is saying to you, trust in his mercy. Maybe God has even put in your heart to take a step on something and you are not sure. God is saying, do not be afraid. He said, my mercy is in abundance to you. My mercy is multiplied to you. So that is one part of it that God has talked about. And now the next thing that he says is peace. Peace. Many people do not have the peace of God. Jesus said, my peace I give you, not like the world gives. He said, because in the world there is tribulation, in the world there is challenges, there's always one issue or the other. But he said, I give you my own peace. So it God see, peace is not an absent saying that, oh, situation, everything is perfect, nothing is going wrong. That's not what it is. Jesus is saying to you that the peace that he gives to you is peace that just like when he was sleeping in the boat that the disciples were on, you know, the storm was there, but he's saying he's giving you a position like the way he was on that boat. You know, there were storms, but he was at rest. And the reason why he can be at rest is because he had a peace that came from his Father. And now Jesus, your Lord and your God, he is your Father. And he's saying to you, I am giving you peace. He's saying to you, I am giving you peace. Over that situation, you know, there are many things that can happen in the life of someone. You can face a tragic situation. I have faced many tragic situations, losing a loved one, people betraying you, facing different difficult situations. Or maybe something that you have prayed to God, you know God gave you that word, you have trusted him on that word, and all of a sudden those things did not come to pass, and you feel like there is an emptiness inside of you. Jesus, in those situations, one of the things that he did was, he gave me his peace. You know, he gave me his peace. And that's one thing that I need you to know. Even if things do not turn out as you expect, yes, you prayed about it. Yes, in fact, last year to this year, I experienced a lot of financial situations. I went into businesses that, and it's as though all my capital went away. All the capital went away. Even the profit I thought I would get from those business opportunities, I did not get them. Instead of getting profit, I was still using part of my own money. There were not interest. I was still spending on those clients. You know, so many things were happening, and I was getting upset with the business contact that gave me those opportunities. That how come all the opportunities that came from you are like more than about four of them, and those things only cost some of them 23 plus millions. They went into a lot of millions, you know, and it's as though all the money just went. That's all I can say. And as bad as all those situations came, I took it back to the Lord. And I kept asking the Lord, I gave my tithe. I did this, I did that. I honored you. Where did it go wrong? So one of the things the Lord told me, the Lord said, the person that you are in that relationship, that you got into that business relationship with, there is something about that person that has not been dealt with. And that gives the enemy legal ground, because the enemy does not want that person to have finance. The devil is also affecting him. By that, you're also affected. Now, there were many ways that I could get those money back. I could use legal means, I could do anything, because I knew what I could do to get those things back. But the Lord told me not to do that. And then I thought about, okay, so what do I do? How do I make up for all those losses? How do I build back again? The only thing the Lord asked me, he said, is it your money or is it my money? I said, it is your money. You know, even though I know how much it cost me to build all these years, and I said, it is your money. One project alone cost about 20 something million. You know, I imagine doing four projects and all of that just went. And the Lord asked me, is it your money or my money? I said, it's your money. I said, let it go. And I'm thinking, how? But even for the funny thing is, because I have worked so closely with him, I know that when he tells me, let it go, I know that the cattle upon 1,000 hills belongs to him. I know that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. I know that all the wealth in the sea belongs to him. I know that if he wants to give me 1 billion times more than what I had lost, he can do that in an hour. It doesn't cost him anything. So because of that, whether those things will ever come back or not, I just told him I would trust him. And guess what? From beginning of last year to this time, May, I experienced all of those things. And it seemed like opportunities were not coming through. But the Lord just told me, give me time. And he told me, in fact, there were months when he told me, stay away from business, stay away from the office, be alone with me. And I stayed alone with him. And I gave my best in any way I could to just keep building with him. And to my amazement, I was not going to the office. I was not putting out adverts. I was not doing anything. But I began to get calls from so many places. Oh, somebody told me about you. Oh, I got your number somewhere. Oh, I want. And then opportunities are just pouring in. You know, so it is not all about that, really, not about finance. But I'm telling you that he can give you peace in the midst of a storm. Many times there are things that the Lord has told me I want to establish in your family, to put an end to a lot of darkness, idolatry, and establish his altar of righteousness. And maybe you are praying for a loved one, you are praying that certain things should not happen to them, certain things should not happen in your life. And it feels like you've been praying for months, years, and it feels like nothing is changing. Can you let his peace come into you? Because Jesus was in that boat. He didn't stop the storm from raging. Yet he was asleep because he had the knowledge that everybody else around him did not have. One of that knowledge is that he knows that he is the Alpha and the Omega. He knows that nothing, except he said, I have the right to lay down my life and take it up again, meaning that nothing can kill him. And this Jesus who is saying all of these things, he is your Father. So if he can be that confident, that's why he's saying it is not your own peace, it is his own peace. That you will know that no matter what you are experiencing, no matter what you are seeing, his peace will keep you in, his perfect peace, shalom, shalom, nothing missing, nothing broken. Because when he walks with you and gives you that peace, not just a little bit of, not a measure of the peace, but I said in abundance and in multiplied measure. So that with every area of your life, have the peace of God. Bible said that the peace of God that surpasses all understanding may guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Let that peace of God, not the peace of your father's house, not the peace of your mother's house, not the peace that comes because you have that money, not the peace that comes because you have that car, because you have that child, because you just got married, because of your spouse, or because of any physical thing, but the peace that comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know how many spiritual things I experience day and night? But I have that peace because I am not alone. It may look like I am alone, but I am not alone. I am conscious of his presence with me every minute of the day. I am never alone. Most people wonder that, how come sometimes you feel like you are alone in that house? I'm saying, I am not alone. My Father is always with me. And because Jesus is my Father, I have come to that consciousness. So let him give you that peace. Even if you are in prison, even if they have said they are about to execute you, let him give you his peace. Yes, you didn't commit that crime. Yes, you feel like you need to
See, there are situations that you are on your right. Just like me, I was on my right. I had the legal means to get all those things back. But Jesus said, walk away from it. And for me, his word is a command. His word is the final authority in my life. I don't care what anybody else is saying. What the minute he has spoken, that's the end. That's the end of it. And you must be that kind of person too. So he's giving you his multiplied peace. Whatever the situation, whatever your body is speaking, you speak peace over your body. You decree, I speak the peace of Jesus over my mind. I speak the peace of Jesus over that circumstance. I speak the peace of Jesus over that child, over that loved one, over that business, over that family, over that ministry, over that situation. I speak the peace of Jesus over every area of my life. Let his peace, not just a peace, but a multiplied peace over every area of my life. You speak his peace. Because you did not get it. He said, I give it to you. So yours is to receive. Like someone saying, I'm sending a package to you. You have a choice to either receive that package or say, no, I don't want it. Now Jesus is saying, I'm giving you my peace in abundance. So you need to accept it today. Over any situation at all, let that peace stay with you. Now the last thing that he talked about is his love. Oh, many people have never experienced what it means to be loved. Many people have never experienced what it is to receive the love. Most people, what they experience as love is a man's expression of love, a woman's expression of love, or parent's expression of love. The love that God has for you goes beyond all of that. It goes beyond, there is nothing in this life that can measure. So that love is so much that he had to give his life for you. Indirectly, he was trying to show you that if you were the only person on earth, he still would have come to die. You are that important. But Jesus talked about the parable. He said that a man saw a treasure in a field, and then he went to sell everything that he had so that he can buy that field. He doesn't need the field. But he needed to buy that field because that is the only way he can get that treasure. You are that treasure. And Jesus bought the entire world with his blood so that he can get you. So because he wants you to know that even if you are the only one, he needs you to know how much he loves you. Jesus loves you. Maybe no one has ever told you before. Now I need you to hear. No one has ever said to you, I love you. No one has ever said to you, I love you. Right now, I need you to hear it as many times. Let it resound in your ears. Let it go deep into your heart. Jesus loves you. I want you to put your name to it. Jesus loves you, Jessica. Jesus loves you, Abel. Jesus loves you, Pierce. Jesus loves you, Olivia. Jesus loves you, Levi, Timothy. Jesus loves you. In Bible, Jesus loves you. Whatever your native name is, Jesus loves you. So you need to know that. And his love here, he said, I'm giving you my love in abundance. I'm giving you my love in a multiplied fashion. He doesn't love you because you do right. He loves you regardless. Bible said that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And he said, how much more now that you are in him? So even if you are listening to this, you don't even have a relation. Maybe you worship other kind of gods. Jesus is saying that while you were not even with him, he already died for you. He didn't wait for you to come to him. He didn't wait for you to make a decision. He's saying that I love you regardless of who you are, regardless of who your father is, regardless of the family you came from. Regardless of whatever your life is like right now, it doesn't matter how many rituals you have made, how many sacrifices, how many things you have done. He's saying that I love you regardless. And if he needs to make a sacrifice for you again, you are that important to him. You are that important to him. I have witnessed certain people in my life that You know, there are some people that I see that they practice occultism or they practice witchcraft, and I see them around me sometimes, and in their mind it's almost like they have power, you know. And I'm not downplaying it, but the reason why I say it this way is because in this my young life, God has allowed me to come in contact with other kind of people who did that. You know, there are ranks in the realm of the spirit, right? And when it comes to the place of God, there are so many people that have ranks to the point that there are those that sit before God. Like for instance, God was talking about Moses. He said, "I speak to him face to face." So there are people who speak to God face to face. It's the same way that there are people who speak to the devil face to face. So when I look at those army who are just trying to exhibit little power that they have, I kind of laugh, because the other people that God has allowed me to experience are those that I know their ranks that they had, that their rank was to the point of speaking to the devil face to face. And I'm not talking somebody just appearing and say, "I am Lucifer," and they're just calling the name, but they are not. It's the one, it is the real person, you know. So I have experienced those things. But in the midst of that, it was God himself. He allowed me to be in that midst. And yet he did not give them power to do me harm. And as I saw the depth that those people had, all of those things, right now, those people are great evangelists for Jesus. I'm telling you, many of them are great evangelists for Jesus. And you know, so many times that I see people expressing some kind of demonic abilities and all of those things, I am not afraid. Secondly, I am not worried. The state of my mind regarding such people is, "Lord, this is another opportunity for you to turn somebody to Christ." You know, so because I have seen that if he can do it with those ones that were that deep, went that far, who is it that he cannot work with when these ones are even lower rank? Where would it, they are not even ranks at all. So in my mind, I know that there is no one he cannot reach. So if he can lock those ones, in fact, there was a particular one that I know that he actually went to his house while he was watching TV, and the statement he made was what amazed me. He said to that one, he said, "My son." And I'm like, do you see what he did to that person? Do you see what sacrifice he did? How he did this to the person? Are you calling your son? But that's the truth. Every human, Bible said he made us in his image and his likeness, so he has the right to call us his son. And you know, if you get up and begin to judge that person, God will come to you and tell you, "Who gave you the right? Who gave you the right?" So if he can do that and can love those people, who are you that he cannot love? Who are you that he cannot bring into his purpose and his destiny? So maybe your father has never told you he loved you. Maybe your mother has never told you. Maybe you experienced certain things and to the point that you eventually got married and you're thinking, "Finally." And then you experience terrible things in your marriage. Well, I want to introduce you to the Father of all spirits. His name is Jesus, and he loves you unconditionally. He does not have a condition. He does not say, "Because you speak well, I love you. Because you dress well, or you smell well, or because your body is well formed," those things do not count. All he looks at is your heart. And many times, even when your heart are wrong, he loves you not because of you, because of who he is. He said God is love. That is his nature. So he loves you regardless of whatever situation. So So these are the things. And here he's saying, I don't just love you, it is in abundance and it is in a multiplied measure. So whatever, maybe in school you are being bullied or people are saying negative things, and it feels like you're somebody who is listening right now, you may even be about to commit suicide and be feeling depressed because people have said so many things and you have tried your best to fit in. Perhaps God does not want you to fit in. Perhaps God needs you to stand out. And I'm saying from experience, because growing up as a young girl, I felt like I needed to be in the midst of many. I feel like I needed to be among many. But I kept hearing the Lord say to me, I did not call you with people, I called you alone. And I found out that truly I couldn't make friends. It bothered me a lot for many years, but after a while, when the Lord began to help me, and I say help because He began to help me realize who I am, I began to build confidence in His words. What is my confidence now was not about anything else, but about what He was saying. So I spent time in His word. What is He saying about me? He said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. In His word, He says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and with my loving kindness, I have drawn you to myself. So He tells me that. He said, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. I love you. And He says to me that no matter what, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I trust every word that He says, but I know that He can never lie. Whether what those things come to pass or not, I don't care. I only know that He loves me, and that is what my confidence is. Whether anybody accepts me or not, it doesn't matter. It's true that you need to have good relationships with people. I don't disregard that. But those relationships do not define who I am. He defines me. That is why more than anything else, I make sure that I can never lose His presence. Because that presence is everything. I can't lose His voice. Is everything. It is all that I have. And I tell you every time, you are all I have. I have friends, I have families, I have some close people to me, but I tell Him all the time, despite all everybody around me, for me, you are all I have. And without you, Jesus, I can do nothing. And because He knows that my heart is sincere when I say that, He pours more of Himself on you. And that's why I'm calling you today. Let Him love you. Let Him show you the kind of experience that He has for you that you have never known. Maybe you have all you have known all your life are people betray you, people take advantage of you. Maybe you've even been abused. Maybe people have done terrible things to you that even those that you thought would protect you did not protect you. I know what those kind of things are. Some of these things I have experienced there. But I can speak today because Jesus never left me. And I'm telling you that He also never left you. And you will say, if He never left you, why did He let things happen? It's not that He let things happen. It's that the hearts of men are desperately wicked. And right now, part of His love is letting you hear this today. Because He wants you to know that despite all that has happened, He has always loved you. I remember when He told me my dad passed away. My brother came home and told everyone at home that my dad had just passed away. He came from the hospital. And I went back into the kitchen because I was already making breakfast. And I remember I under my breath, I said, Holy Spirit, so now I'm an orphan. And He said to me, no, you are not an orphan. He said, I said, I am your father, and I have always been, and I have always wanted you to know. He said, from now on, anything you need, anything you want, ask me. That was in 2006. Until date, He has never failed in His fatherly position or responsibility towards me. There were times when I messed up really bad, but I knew I could always run to His arms and cry at His feet and say, Daddy, I messed up. And He will simply hold me, pull my head up and tell me, I love you regardless. And He helps me up and He begins to help me guard my path again so I can be on the right path. I'm telling you also, He loves you. He has never left you. He is your Father. You need to see him as Father. You need to don't just see him as a mighty God that he is, as someone who consumes with fire. He is all of that. He's a judge, yes. But when Jesus taught us to pray, he didn't teach us to say, "Oh, great, powerful God with fire." No, Jesus said, you start by saying, "Abba, Father," which means my daddy, my source, my helper, my protector, my sustainer, my keeper. He's the one. You can't protect your family. He alone can protect. You can't even protect yourself. You can't defend yourself. That is, I have learned all of that. And why I'm able to know that is because of his love for me. And that love is what he is coming to share with you today. This video has taken longer than I expected, but I hope it has blessed you. I hope it has encouraged you to know that the Father loves you deeply. Like, I don't even know how to express it. But his love is so powerful that when you begin to experience it, you will never, like just as I am, you will never want to be away from his presence. Because that is just who he is. So like he said, his mercy he gives you, his peace he gives you, and his love he gives you. But he doesn't just give you just like that. He gives you all of that in abundance, regardless of what you've done, regardless of what your past is, regardless even if you don't know how many people have killed, he loves you. You don't know how many people have deceived, have duped, he loves you, even in that state. You don't know how many men or women I have slept with, he loves you. You are the one who needs to accept his love, his mercy, and for you to be at peace in your heart that your daddy loves you. So once again, thank you for being here, and I pray that the mercy, the peace, and the love of Jesus that surpass all understanding will guard your heart, will guard your mind, and will help you all every day of your life. In Jesus' name I pray. If you are listening to this, and perhaps you don't even know Jesus, you've never had a relationship with him, you don't even know what he is like, well, would you like to be in a relationship with him so that all these things that you've heard, you can begin to experience it? Let us pray then. Just say everything you hear me say. Say, "Lord Jesus, I have heard everything this lady has talked about. I want a relationship with you. So today, I come before you and I ask you, give me your mercy, give me your peace, and give me your love that never ends. Because I want you in my life. Come and take control of everything that concerns me. In Jesus' name." If you have said that, I want you to know that Jesus has heard you, and today he comes to you. Let us pray. Let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your son, for your daughter, who has made this prayer. Father, it is your will that all men will come to you, and that no one will be lost. So Lord, I present them to you today. And I ask you, please reach out to them. Show these ones your mercy. Show them your loving kindness. And give them your peace in abundance in such multiplied way that they will never be exhausted with it. In the name of Jesus, come and wrap yourself around them. Some have never experienced love. Let this be the beginning of their love journey with you. In Jesus' name, Holy Spirit, fill their hearts and their spirits with your presence. Let them know that they are safe in you and with you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here. Thank you for joining. And I don't know why God is putting this in my heart. Perhaps there is someone that, maybe someone that is close to you, almost like, you know, when, like a pimp that gives out, that watches over certain kind of ladies and gives them out for men to have sexual relationship with them for money. Or maybe there is someone who is like a guardian or someone who has an authority over you, and this person has been abusing you one way or the other, have been taking advantage of you, and you'll be thinking, God, will you never deliver me from this? For the Lord to put it in my heart, I want you to know that Bible says that God always finds a way for us to escape from those things. So now I'm not going to tell you to try to jump the fence or do anything, but I'm going to tell you this. Today that Jesus has come to you, he's going to make changes. Those things will never happen again. The next time, I need you to trust him. Whenever this person shows up, I need you to be bold to say, your dad is saved, you must not do it again. That your Jesus said you must not do it again. And if they insist that you must, then I need you to call on Jesus. Because he is sending help to you. Yes, he's sending help. He put it in my heart right now. His help is coming. You need to trust him and thank him, because he's going to get you out of that place. You are not a slave to anyone. You are not a servant. Your body belongs to Jesus, and he does not abuse. He doesn't take advantage. He is the one who gave his life for you so that you will never have to sacrifice yourself. So God bless you. And if you need someone to communicate with, we have our contacts here. You can always send messages, go on our Facebook and just send us messages, or even on WhatsApp, or even make a call. Someone will be there to help you. In Jesus' name. Thank you. God bless you, and bye-bye.